Standing at the border between Guatemala and Mexico. Up there on the bridge, there's a normal border crossing with migration people stamping passports. But you go down these wobbly stairs, you notice that right under the bridge, these guys are trafficking people across the border, technically illegally.
You can't tell that there's been an immigration crackdown here. But there has, and it was the U.S. that paid for it.
These guys are doing it under the noses of immigration officials who clearly don't care that much.
You only start to feel this crackdown when you start moving north, where you run into a new network of military infrastructure and checkpoints meant to stop migrants. But this crackdown was never meant to keep Central Americans out of Mexico. It was meant to keep them out of Texas. In 2014, the United States sent an influx of money to Mexico, helping them militarize and fortify their southern border region. To understand why, you have to look at this chart. The red line represents the number of Mexican migrants apprehended while they're crossing into the United States, and the green line is for non-Mexican migrants. Look at 2014. That's when the number of non-Mexican migrants outnumbered Mexican migrants for the very first time. What pushed this number up were the migrants coming from Honduras, El Salvador, and Guatemala. And these people fleeing from Central America aren't just looking for jobs. They're running away.
So there's a war going on in Central America right now. It's actually not just one war, it's a ton of micro-wars.
Unbelievable violence.
Nearly one homicide an hour.
Three of the five highest homicide countries in the world. Honduras, Guatemala, and El Salvador.
Carved up the city into warring factions.
Una doña que tenía un negocio, le quitaron así, mira, cuatro dedos. Porque no pagó en el momento el impuesto.
Residents of these towns are at major risk of dying, and so people are fleeing.
While riding with the U.S. Border Patrol on the Texas border, I watched them apprehend a 22-year-old and his son as they just made the three-week journey up through Mexico from Honduras.
Vengo amenazado de muerte. Porque mi hijo y yo corremos peligro en mi país. No puedo regresar a mi país porque...
These refugees walk into Mexico, mostly hoping to make it to the U.S. Many come here to this town called Tapachula, just north of the border, where they can look for a migrant shelter to lie low and get support. And at this vulnerable point in their journey, many don't want to show their face on camera.
And there were these threats just constantly came and came and came to me. And then one day I just said, the hell with this, I'm gone. Mm-hmm. I burned my little rancho and I took off at 2 o'clock in the morning.
The exodus out of Central America came to a head in 2014, when the U.S. saw a huge spike in the number of Central American kids and teens arriving to the border without a parent.
It is a huge humanitarian crisis on the border right now.
52,000 unaccompanied children have been caught at the U.S. border with Mexico, double the number recorded last year.
Children from Honduras traveling into Guatemala, then Mexico, crossing the Rio Grande, and just now arriving in Texas.
As soon as it became clear that this year's migration to the border was different than in past years, I directed FEMA to coordinate our response at the border.
Obama declared an urgent humanitarian situation at the border. He discussed it with Mexican President Peña Nieto. Peña Nieto walked away from that meeting and immediately implemented a policy called the Programa Frontera Sur, the Southern Border Program.
And earlier this week, Mexico announced a series of steps that they're going to take on their southern border to help stem the tide.
For Peña Nieto, the plan had two main objectives.
Uno, proteger y salvaguardar los derechos humanos de los migrantes que ingresan y transitan por México. Y dos, a incrementar el desarrollo y la seguridad de la región.
In short, the plan was supposed to make life better and safer for both migrants and those living in the border region, which includes Mexico's most impoverished state, Chiapas. This migrant protection plan for the southern border had been in the works for years, but it was rushed into implementation, apparently in response to American pressure. Many of the long-term plans that were meant to give migrants legal support and protection fell away, Instead, the implementation focused almost entirely on enforcement and security.
What's easiest to do, I think, is enforcement, because you already have the infrastructure set up. Like, it's harder to create jobs, right, than it is to hire more immigration agents to detain people.
Mexico's quick solution to this was to militarize, to start raiding buses, to start putting up checkpoints, to start cracking down on Central Americans who were coming into their country. A perfect symbolic representation of this are these huge multi-agency complexes that they built in order to house the immigration officials alongside the Army and the Marines and the Federal Police.
Mexico fortified its southern border region. And to help in the effort, the U.S. sent an influx of money and equipment, using resources from an existing security partnership it had with Mexico dating back to 2007. This partnership was originally created to combat drug trafficking and organized crime. The money was used here for things like inspection equipment, canine teams, observation towers, training for immigration enforcement officials, communication networks to support enforcement activities, and gear to collect biometric data like fingerprints and photos of detained migrants. In short, the U.S. helped militarize the southern border region of Mexico.
The U.S. got what it was looking for.
In part because of strong efforts by Mexico, including at its southern border, we've seen those numbers reduced back to much more manageable levels.
Apprehensions on the Mexican side went up, and people arriving to Texas or other parts of the U.S. border went down.
But this was all temporary. The number jumped back up in 2016. So the crackdown isn't actually stopping people from getting to the United States, but it is making their journey much more dangerous.
Behind me is the train that Central Americans take to get from here in southern Mexico up to the border with the United States. If it were 2014, this area would be completely packed with migrants.
Migration officials targeted this train. They started conducting extensive raids, and the train companies hired guards, increasing the speeds of the trains and installing concrete posts and walls to make it harder for people to jump aboard. And now, gangs are a constant threat to the few travelers that remain. Here are the main routes that migrants took to get to the United States. They mainly followed the train routes. These paths were well supported with migrant shelters and clinics, and most importantly, large groups of other migrants, making it less likely that people will be robbed or assaulted. Migrants often don't know where their next meal will come from or where they're going to sleep each night. They depend on this network of usually church-sponsored shelters as they move north. The 2014 crackdown targeted these routes, looking for migrants in popular places like shelters and train stops. So migrants moving north have shifted into unfamiliar, unsupported routes that multiply the dangers that they are already subject to on this journey.
Como es monte, entonces le pueden salir ladrones, o es peligroso.
Pushing these refugees away from well-trodden routes and into the shadows has made them more vulnerable to assaults by criminals and gangs in this region.
A él le pegaron con la pistola en la cabeza, lo golpearon y jaló a la niña. A mí me jaló a la niña, ella jaló a la niña y le dije, suéltela, la está lastimando, y la niña llorando. La está lastimando y si no la suelta voy a gritar, le dije.
During this time, the U.S. Border Patrol started putting out public service announcements about how dangerous the journey through Mexico had become. This, in spite of the fact that U.S. policy contributed to those risks.
Que hoy sea más fácil que nuestros hijos consigan papeles en el norte, es falso. Que los estamos haciendo presa fácil de coyotes, la bestia y el desierto, es cierto.
All of the shelter directors I talked to have noticed an uptick in crimes against migrants since this crackdown. A study by dozens of migration organizations in Mexico found that of the 5,824 investigations into crimes against migrants, less than 1% had led to any sort of sentence. And many crimes go unreported altogether. There's not a lot of trust in the Mexican justice system for migrants.
y le decía uno al otro, matemos los bolos y los llevamos para adentro. Ahí se ponen que pensar uno, tocó sacar lo que traíamos.
Porque nosotros venimos huyendo de este problema de nuestro país y lo venimos a encontrar acá con el problema, entonces seguimos en lo mismo.
Most migrants are now left on their own, navigating this remote region where both gangs and corruption-prone police are looking for ways to profit off vulnerable migrants.
Aprovecha su cargo de ser guardián o ser vigilante para detener a ellos y sobre todo amenazarlos, o sea, decir, si tú no me das nada, yo te deporto.
Fíjense, lo supe yo que por cada migrante que agarran les dan 200 pesos, es un negocio lo que tienen ellos, ¿ya?
Hay un problema grande ahí de la corrupción y la impunidad, y los migrantes entonces prefieren seguir invisibles.
But perhaps the most egregious offense of the Mexican state in this crackdown comes down to what they didn't do for these people entering their country. When a Mexican immigration official detains a migrant, that officer is required to inform them that they have the right to ask for refugee status or asylum if they're fleeing for their lives. Everyone I talked to said that isn't happening.
There were 40,000 children who entered into Mexico in 2016, and these children aren't looking for jobs, they're not smuggling drugs. They're looking for protection. Of the 40,000 that came here, only 1% applied for asylum. That's a dangerously low number for a country that has said that it protects asylum seekers.
Migrants who feel a threat to their lives in their own country have to fill out an application and submit it to an agency that has the power to grant asylum or refugee status in Mexico. This allows them to avoid being deported, to stay in the country. But this agency that's in charge of processing these applications only had 15 caseworkers dedicated to interviewing these applicants. And while applications are on pace to be 12 times what they were in 2013, this group's budget only grew 5% during the crackdown. The year the Southern Border Program was implemented, Mexico detained around 119,000 Central Americans. It granted refugee status to only 460 of them, not even a half a percent. That same year, Mexico started deporting a lot more Central Americans. So the Southern Border Program made Mexico a lot better at detaining and deporting people, but it definitely didn't make Mexico a safer place for refugees like it said it would.
Now let's get one thing straight. Mexico has the right and the sovereignty to fortify its borders and to control who's coming in and out. That is their right as a sovereign nation. And some will wonder, why is it Mexico's problem to deal with, you know, the problems and challenges of citizens of another country? The problem is, Mexico has signed all of the international conventions that promise that they will take care of asylum seekers or refugees and give them the legal protection so that they can feel safe.
Mexico no ha firmado algunas. Mexico ha firmado absolutamente todos los instrumentos internacionales que hay en materia de derecho de asilo.
A report by the Migration Policy Institute found that in 2014, the U.S. deported just 3 of every 100 unaccompanied children that it apprehended on the border. Mexico, on the other hand, deported 77 for every 100 kids it apprehended. And yet, when thousands of unaccompanied children arrived at Texas's border in 2014, the U.S. turned to Mexico to handle the delicate and difficult work of screening and protecting these refugees fleeing for their lives. The U.S. is paying Mexico to do its dirty work, knowing full well that doing this will result in a much more dangerous situation for refugees. It drove them into the shadows, worsening their vulnerabilities, and in most cases, deporting them back to the violent places from which they came.
Y al final de lo que estamos hablando un poco más en abstracto es de negarle a una persona su último derecho. Cuando ya no tienes derechos de ningún tipo en tu propio país, el último derecho que te queda es pedir protección en un país seguro.
One of the questions I know I'm going to get a ton is, what is the name of this waterfall? Southern Mexico is full of a lot of very beautiful scenery, and I got to see a lot of it as I was traipsing around the region reporting the story. But this waterfall, it's called El Chiflón, and it's in the state of Chiapas in southern Mexico. It ended up being one of the most beautiful things I'd ever seen in all of my borders reporting this summer. Especially once I got the drone up in the air and saw from above El Chiflón in Chiapas. Beautiful place.